Hello, this is part two of a summary of the fanfic Fallout Equestria by kkat. Part one covers the events leading up to the fall of the old world and the creation of the wasteland. This part will be covering post-war events from the last day, up until Pip leaves the stable, and also her story. In case you skipped the first part, feel free to be listening. You'll be able to understand everything discussed here. Now, as I mentioned in part one, Fallout Equestria is a very long story. So long that publishing companies would refuse to publish it as a single volume, but rather force it to be a trilogy or, more likely, a series. The basic summary is therefore just that, a basic summary. It will not cover everything, but it will cover the important things. It won't cover everything in great detail either, but it will be enough for you to understand what happened. But only what happened. This is already going to be about an hour long, just with a summary of events. I do not have the time to succinctly summarize character development throughout this story, nor character relationships, which are a major driving force of Fallout Equestria. If you want to experience those, I highly recommend you read the story. However, in spite of the spoilers of the events, you will be missing out on not all that much by being exposed to this video. The idea here being it's an event summary, and since Fallout Equestria is so character-driven and almost entirely about the psychology of the main character as she goes through the wasteland, the spoilers don't actually affect that much. Now let's get going, and obviously, spoilers ahead. We're going to start with the things that happened between the last day and the day Stable 2 opened. This period of time is referred to as the post-war era. Very little is known about this time period for certain. Wastelanders are struggling to feed themselves day to day and don't tend to write much down. While plenty of events took place during this time, the details are fuzzy at best. Perhaps the most important and earliest event in the Wasteland's history is the reformation of the Grand Pegasus Enclave from a loose group of traitorous equestrian soldiers into a Pegasi-exclusive nation above the clouds. As the balefire consuming Equestria began to burn out, a large group of Pegasi, the majority of Equestria's Sky Guard, not only maintained the curtain of clouds that they had covered Equestria in, but also used it as the new ground for the formation of their new nation. They called this nation the Grand Pegasus Enclave. It took the form of a military junta, and it bullied almost all Pegasi into joining it as a citizen or be killed. The Enclave was never meant to be a permanent or long-lasting government. It was intended only as a stopgap measure to keep Equestrian civilization and culture alive, albeit in a twisted form. The Enclave was only intended to exist until the world below could be reclaimed, or at least the radiation levels had gone down enough for people to start reclaiming things and build on the ground once more. However, as the years ticked by and the wasteland remained a hellish place of contamination with no end in sight, the Enclave found itself to be a lot like fixing a ripped tarp with duct tape, a temporary fix turned permanent. The Enclave was able to maintain itself by using select features of the single Pegasus project to make large sections of their cloud blanket equivalent to the Earth for growing crops. This didn't provide as much food as they'd hoped, leading to strict rationing and government control over how many children its citizens were allowed to have, and eventually even who would be allowed to have children at all. The Enclave became obsessed with purity, likely as a side effect from finding the world below and the ponies that inhabit it to be impure, contaminated, dangerous mutants. The Enclave also mined away the top halves of entire mountains for resources. We know that at some point they fought a war against the Griffins, which resulted in them losing much of what they had saved during the last day. In spite of these hardships, the Enclave remained one of, if not the most technologically advanced faction in the Wasteland, and they certainly remained the largest military power. Of course, they did so little in the Wasteland that your average pony didn't even know they should have an opinion on whether or not the myth of pre-war Pegasi cities in the sky was true or not. This is the opposite of the next largest military faction, the Steel Rangers. Almost every Wastelander has an opinion about them, specifically a negative one. The Steel Rangers largely survived the last day due to having access to shelters on the military bases they were stationed, or by their armor keeping them alive through the bombardment. Though a non-insignificant number of rangers who were outside during the last day became ghouls. The rangers were also able to make contact with each other across the wasteland via military radio systems. They waited until the megaspell fallout was mostly gone, and then emerged into the wasteland where they formed into many contingents, most importantly the Manhattan, Philadelphia, and Trottingham contingents. One would assume that hundreds, if not thousands, of power armor-clad pre-war soldiers who had sworn to protect Equestria and its citizens entering into the wasteland would be a good thing. It was not. The The end of the world caused the Rangers to shift priority. The post-war Steel Rangers had one shared mission, to find and recover any and all advanced technology that survived the war. The Rangers work around the clock to collect, catalog, and research any technology they can find, in the hopes of one day being able to duplicate it. In their eyes, their primary duty is to restore the world that was. Individual wastelanders they could be helping mean nothing compared to the reclaiming the technology needed to construct highways to permit the future millions of ponies quick transportation between their newly created cities. This misguided obsession, combined with their ruthlessness and shoot-first-ask-questions-never attitude, makes them one of the most advanced factions in the Equestrian Wasteland. It also makes them the most dangerous of all Wasteland factions, given that most Steel Ranger soldiers are equipped with a suit of power armor, an autocannon, and a grenade machine gun, all of which have endless amounts of ammunition due to magical talismans recreating munitions as they're expended. Wastelanders tend to drop anything electronic or arcane they are carrying and run if they see a Ranger walking towards them. Of course, not all major Wasteland factions are violent technophiles. Some of them are simply slices of the old world, maintained by wealthy families who were too wealthy before the war as well. One such example of these kinds of places is Tenpony Tower. Tenpony is an absurdly secure hotel, thanks to housing a Ministry of Arcane Science hub on the upper floors, and also being built as a place to hide the control system for the superweapon known as Celestia Prime. Its hidden, reinforced construction allowed it to survive the war mostly intact, with only superficial damage to the one side of the facade. Over time, the tower's surviving occupants made repairs to the damaged exterior and had the ground floor entrance sealed off, reinforced, and barricaded. They largely secluded themselves from the wasteland and only allowed very select new residents to take up for, well, residence. It is a bastion of high society in the wasteland. It's got marble walls, gold chandeliers, and preserves the crafts of fancy cuisine and high culture. Despite their haughty pretense, its occupants largely perform menial labor and scavenging, using the sheer bulk of Manhattan megacity to keep up a constant supply of pre-war goods to fulfill their lifestyle's needs. Tenpony does, however, perform a single charitable function for the entirety of the wasteland. It is home to DJ Pony, your voice in the wilderness. There has always been a DJ Pony. Many theorize that DJ is an immortal of some kind. In reality, one DJ Pony passes the mantle and the voice changer to the next when the time comes. Tenpony's ministry hub provides access to the SPP network's communication system and spy network, allowing the current DJ to both see everything that happens in the wasteland and report those happenings to any pony with a working radio. They also play music from a limited library of ministry-approved singles. Of course, not all wasteland groups existed before the war. One was born on the last day, in a vat of alchemical mutagens. The pseudo-eldritch horror known as the Goddess, an amalgamation of the memories, bodies, abilities, and goals of several ponies, all of which were twisted by a deep-seated madness, or possibly brain damage, given that all four brains within the Goddess were melted at least a little. The Goddess founded a group she calls the Unity. Calling the Unity group is a little misleading, though. The Unity is a hive mind controlled by the Goddess herself. The Unity is composed primarily of alicorns, only primarily because the only other entity is the Goddess, which you cannot possibly describe as anything other than a terrifying pile of flesh. All other members of the Unity were, at some point or another, ponies, specifically ponies who found their way into the Maripony facility, which the Goddess then dunked into the vats of industrial quantities of impelled metamorphosis potion that had been created there for the war effort. These ponies were transformed into alicorns, as intended by Twilight Sparkle, who had invented the potion in the pre-war days. However, the potion was meant to be drunk, and has a specific dose. Dipped alicorns are alicorns in shape only. They are mutant creatures that exclusively come in purple, blue, or green. Their coat grants them a magical ability, either teleportation, invisibility, or telepathy, respectively. Additionally, alicorns retain the knowledge of any spells they had before being transformed. Fun fact, Unity is a hive mind. What one of them knows, they all know, because they're just one person. So all alicorns have the spells of all other alicorns. This makes every single one of them an archmage. Since that's not bad enough for the wasteland, alicorns are also healed by radiation, even supercharged by it. They become physically larger, more powerful, and their coats turn a deep black color if exposed to sufficient amounts of radiation. They also obviously have no free will, so long as the goddess's psychic field can reach them, which it always can, except for within patches of pink cloud for whatever reason. Alicorns are also immune to one of the wasteland's biggest environmental hazards, Taint. Taint is what Wastelanders call the bits of industrial waste that came from the process of creating the potion that makes the alicorns. It got spread all over the place, particularly the failed batches of the stuff. Now, so, well, those batches and those canisters and just piles of sludge were meant to be safely disposed of by various pre-war companies, but they weren't. Taint is a big reason why pony civilization hasn't reemerged. A lot of places are simply lethal, but not to alicorns. Alicorns are perfectly adapted to the wasteland. This is why the Unity's goal is to convert all ponies into alicorns. Oddly enough, for a hive mind, the Unity gives you a choice to join. It's a false choice, as the goddess is incredibly persuasive, but a choice is given. Join or die. Unless you're not a pony, then the Unity just kills you. Non-ponies are not part of the goddess's plan. In her ultimate vision of the world, all other species are a threat and will have to be wiped out or entirely subjugated. As if a hive mind of mutant supermares, power-armored techno-barbarians, snooty dickbags who won't share controlling the news, and racist cloud dwellers who could save the wasteland but instead choose to wait for it to die were not bad enough for the wasteland to have to deal with, there is, of course, one other major faction. A faction united by absolutely nothing. A faction with no goals other than personal entertainment. A faction that is seemingly endless and even more effective at self-propagating than the Unity. Raiders. Raiders are not bandits. Bandits are ponies who will attack others to steal their stuff. Bandits do not generally burn down villages. Bandits want other groups to keep living so they can steal more stuff in the future. Bandits are just bad people. Raiders are fundamentally broken ponies that have been magically corrupted to the point where they cannot feel empathy nor care about the lives of others anymore. They seek only their own pleasure, and to their twisted minds, pleasure is drugs, rape, and murder. But not just any murder, creative murder. Making a filly shoot her mother, cut out her mother's heart, and then eat it before raping the filly to death via her throat, that is the kind of thing raiders are about. Raiders' actions and activities create more raiders from the victims they leave behind more often than not. This is either a magical, self-perpetuating curse, which was caused by exposure to balefire in a similar fashion to ghouls, or is just the result of the sheer psychological damage raiders cause to their victims. It's unclear, but either or both is very likely. Even worse, raiders can work together. They just almost never work together in really large numbers. They tend to form small gangs and fight amongst themselves just as much as they fight Wastelanders. And of course, the final faction of the Wasteland is the Wastelanders. Ponies who cling to life in some small corner of the world by whatever means they can manage, united only by their shared misery and the hostile world they inhabit. This common pony is a part of nothing bigger than their family or a dinky little village. They probably live in filth, are constantly starving, and desperate to survive. So desperate that they might be willing to sell a pony to slavers for a hot meal, or join the Unity, or just one day snap and become a raider. Those are the people one can find in the Wasteland. Hardly a nice bunch to be around. Of course, the megaspell rain didn't just change the culture, it changed the world. All infrastructure was essentially lost. Monsters were mutated into even worse forms, and new hazards were born. Most notably, the world is covered in balefire radiation. Balefire radiation is the magical residue of larger, more harmful spells that used balefire. When a living creature is exposed to balefire radiation, the radiation accumulates in its body over time. It's important to note that when radiation is brought up in Fallout Equestria, it's not the product of atomic decay. It's the product of necromantic materials decaying. It's far worse and more insidious than mere electrons, protons, and neutrons flying off of their atom. These strong necromantic components within balefire, and prolonged exposure to them specifically, can cause mutations of varying severity. While many radiation-caused mutations are harmful or even lethal, some may be neutral, and a very select few can be advantageous. Of course, most ponies who survive radiation that alters them in any substantial way become a ghoul being an undead creature similar to a zombie, except they might survive a headshot. It's important to note that ghouls come in many different flavors based on the megaspell that created them, as it seems all megaspells make ghouls, not just balefire. One should also note that many ghouls remain sapient, with their living personality still intact. Whether or not this is a kindness or a cruelty, it's a matter of opinion. There's plenty of other hells out there in the wastes too. For example, the plant previously called Poison Joke, which would magically transform those who touched it in a typically harmless and silly way as a sick form of practical joke, became full-on fiendish. now applies a usually lethal and deeply ironic transformation to its victims. An example is a zebra who once remarked about feeling as if she were an earth pony whose stripes were gaping wounds to try and explain racism to another pony. Well, she had Killing Joke flay the stripes from her body right down to the bone. Then, of course, there's the previously mentioned taint. What wasn't discussed previously about taint is that it's mobile. Taint-based mutations are exceptionally common. Most of the Wasteland's brand new horrible monsters are the product of taint. These creatures spread taint wherever they go. It's a part of their very biological makeup. Examples of taint-based creatures include the bloat sprites, floaters, hellhounds, and David Cronenberg waifus, hospital whores. That's the Wasteland as it was for centuries, filled with lethal environmental dangers and teeming with hostile groups out only for themselves, some of which have serious technological advantages, or are a slowly spreading hive mind of archmages, or just absolute psychopaths. It was into this world that a stable dweller emerged from their safe subterranean shelter, bright-eyed, hopeful, and ready to take on the Wasteland as part of a personal mission. Oh no, we're not talking about Pip yet. We're talking about the other one. We're talking about Red Eye. Red Eye grew up in Stable 101. His stable offered medical and technological advantages far in excess of pre-war civilization. Ponies in the highest ranks of stable tech conspired to make Stable 101 an experiment in rulership through the Earth Pony way. Red Eye firmly believed that the stable inhabitants were being closed-minded, hoarding technology and medicine. He believed the stable's inhabitants were not following Stable 101's core belief of Earth Pony leadership. So he killed them all, except for a few friends to help him out later. One would assume that a pony who killed medicine hoarders in an apocalypse would be a good pony. One would be wrong. Very wrong. But only sort of. Red Eye was an ends-justify-the-means pony. His stable upbringing meant he was educated, unlike most Wastelanders. This allowed him to invent, innovate, and manipulate others. Through various means, Red Eye gained the loyalties of many raider gangs, who he used as grunts in an ever-growing army to further his goal, rebuild Equestria. Red Eye could often be heard on the radio talking about building a better world, restoring things to the way they were. He was sincere in these beliefs. He was working to those ends. But to achieve them, he single-handedly started the Wasteland slave trade in order to have sufficient laborers. He massacred every pony he couldn't enslave in Philadelphia in order to make it one of his bases of operations. He managed to ally with the Unity, feeding the goddess fresh bodies to transform, which he'd pre-broken of will so they couldn't resist her, all in exchange for some magical assistance here and there. Red Eye's army routinely takes over settlements that grow too large for his liking. This is because Red Eye believes only his designs for the future should be carried out. Red Eye has what is called a god complex, literally, and more so than most with a god complex. His ultimate goal after meeting the goddess and learning exactly what she was and how she came to be was to study this accident to later recreate the accident which formed her, but better, in order to become the same kind of entity himself, but better, and serve as new Equestria's ruler until the very end of time. This would make Red Eye terrifyingly stupid if he wasn't a genuine genius, consistently shown to be smarter, wiser, and more cunning than everyone else. His plans work. Take your picture of the world that you previously had. Now update it to have most raiders being unified into a massive army, whose leader doesn't care about what they do so long as they feed him slaves in large numbers who can at least perform basic labor for a few months before dropping dead. It was into this more hellish wasteland that a stable dweller emerged from their safe subterranean shelter, bright-eyed, hopeful, and ready to take on the Wasteland as part of their personal mission. Now we're talking about Pip. More specifically, we're talking about the place that created her. Stable 2 seems to be entirely normal and merely a control stable on the surface. However, this isn't entirely correct. Stable 2 actually did hold an experiment, one where an artificial religion was created in order to revere the royal sisters as literal actual gods. Why Stable Tech chose to do this is never stated, but it means every pony who grew up within Stable 2 believes very fervently that the sisters were actual divine entities. It's also important to notice that Stable 2 had a bit of a problem with its population. Specifically, incest-based birth defects were becoming common due to how long it had been sealed and the number of ponies that had started out inside the stable. Both of these factors are very essential to understanding Pip, especially her mentality. So Stable 2 is chugging along as a nice, safe, happy underground city. It's got industry, entertainment, and everything a pony could want. Well, most things a pony could want. It's still a small self-contained system, so things can be a little boring most of the time. This is why Stable 2's pop idol, Velvet Remedy, is so important and so beloved by pretty much every pony in the stable. However, there is one mare who loves Velvet a little more than most, a Pip Buck repair technician named Little Pip. This is because Pip has the wettest clam bake for Velvet. We are talking Niagara Falls back there. The gay is super strong with Pip. So strong that when Velvet comes by Pip's shop and asks her to take off her Pip Buck for some routine maintenance, Pip does so instantly and without question, primarily because she can't actually talk to Velvet. Pip also doesn't question the fact that Velvet doesn't want her Pip Buck back quickly and tells Pip that she should take her time fixing it and that she'll pick it up tomorrow. Our hero is so deeply flustered that Senpai noticed her that she agrees to this violation of policy and protocol without so much of a thought other than, now, because Velvet can't be tracked, she pieces out of Stable 2 to go out into the wasteland. You see, she never wanted to be a pop star. She wanted to be a wasteland doctor. She just felt the deep-seated need to help the ponies trapped above her, and also apparently didn't realize that the world above is just objectively hell and not stable but kind of crappy. Now, Pip felt that Velvet leaving was all her fault, so when she discovered the stable door's password saved in Velvet's Pip Buck, Pip followed after. The thing is, Stable 2 was sending a search party for Velvet. They liked Velvet. They didn't care about Pip as much. Pip was warned that if she left, she could never return. So Pip left anyways, promising to bring Velvet back. So Pip, this tiny, barely bigger than filly-sized, somewhat derpy mare, is now standing in the remains of Sweet Apple Acres outside of Ponyville. She's freaked out by everything since, well, the hell she entered is the exact opposite of everything she knew. Fortunately for Pip, she runs into a pony named Monterey Jack, who amazingly doesn't just shoot the stable dweller for her shit. Instead, they have the waster equivalent of a polite conversation between strangers, and then Jack borrows her things without permission or intent to return. This conversation is interrupted by some helpful raiders, whose arrival allows Pip to excuse herself from the very awkward and binding conversation. Pip then decides to go explore this nearby town that she can see. It's called Ponyville, and it's a raider nest. Pip has a lovely time getting shot at and learning what grenades are there. She then passes out in the carousel boutique in Lucid dress, because she's a lipstick lesbian, I guess. Also, she kills her first pony, and against all odds, she survives this and manages to only have a small mental break at the violence and the death and the killing. And she even gets a few guns and then retrieves the things that Monterey Jack borrowed from her. Pip then encounters a sprite bot being controlled by a hacker called Watcher. He decides to have a conversation with her and goes on for a bit about virtues and the old world and pony psychology, then just sort of leaves while pretending not to be incredibly important. After which, Pip encounters her first ghoul, who happens to be Ditsy Doo. Unfortunately, the Muffin Mare had her tongue cut out at some point and can't talk, but she's ever so grateful for being rescued from raiders. As a result, she gives Pip a copy of her book, The Wasteland Survival Guide. Then she neumes off, leaving Pip to wonder how the buck she can fly with wings that jacked up. Pip then decides to get the buck away from Ponyville before more raiders shows up. She follows Velvet's trail as best she can and makes her way to a gun factory where she fights some robots, manages to pick herself up with her telekinesis at one point, finds a really nice revolver, and also a stealth buck. Now that she's better equipped and has a cloaking device, she continues on, learning about things like the Ministry of Morale and Pinkie Pie. She listens to a speech by Red Eye on the radio, not knowing who that is, and, more importantly, she almost gets fatally shot by a Pegasus stallion with a really cool hat. Cool hat McCrackshot, proper name Calamity, turns out to be super nice, actually, for a wastelander. He's real sorry for shooting Pip, as he thought she was a raider since she was coming from Ponyville's direction. Shooting raiders on sight is Calamity's policy. So Calamity and some of his friends nurse Pip back to health, and it turns out that he lives in this post-war town called New Appaloosa, which is where Ditsy is living too. She's real happy to see Pip again and writes her a thank you note, which is apparently the first time she's actually ever properly said anything to anyone in a very long time. After the thank you note is delivered, Calamity apologizes a little bit more to Pip with some booze and a history lesson. He then explains that bottle caps are actually money now. Pip is then sent on a quick mission by the town to the nearby stable 24, simply because she has a Pip Buck and lived in a stable, so who better to do a quick errand involving a stable? Calamity tags along, feeling a little guilty for having shot her. While they're walking over, Pip sees an alicorn in the distance, and is really confused by this, mistaking it for Celestia watching her over. Anyways, it turns out the stable 24 is full of these horrible chimera creatures. Calamity gets poisoned. Pip activates her cloaking device to save him via obtaining a handy antidote the stable happened to have. They then blow the stable the buck up before the monsters can spread to the wasteland and scoot back to New Appaloosa, where Pip gets some training in telekinesis as a thank you. That whole getting shot to TK training was all in one day, by the way. Health potions, fuck yeah. Also, Pip's special talent really should have been telekinesis because she's stupid good at it, but can't cast any other spells. So the next day, Pip learns about DJ Pony and hangovers. She's so hungover that Calamity offers her some drugs to help with the hangover, specifically the charisma and intelligence boosting party time mentals. They super do help with the hangover, but it turns out Pip is very easily addicted. Whoops. Pip then finds an Applejack figurine and keeps it, probably because she's a brony. She also gets her first set of armor and gets involved in an attack on old Appaloosa, and during this, she learns where a velvet is. Even better, Calamity is ever so grateful for being given a dose of not die in Stable 24 that he decides to accompany Pip on her journey. Pip and Calamity pull some shenanigans in old Appaloosa to disrupt the slavers working out of it and manage to free Velvet. Velvet is very grateful for this, but is also a real Karen about it. It's very weird. Anyways, she joins the party in time for Pip to run into her first Alicorn. This Alicorn is pissed the buck off that the slaving operation's being disrupted, and a fight ensues, with the Alicorn stealing Jason Voorhees' entire bit by refusing to die and also just being a huge, horrifying problem. Anyways, Pip manages to telekinesis like she's never telekinesis before and bludgeons the Alicorn to death with a train car. Again, her special talent really should have been in telekinesis. One can only imagine how ludicrously good her Pipbuck repair skills are if she can yeet loaded train cars. So Pip and company take a non-yeeted train back to New Appaloosa. They get ambushed by some griffin mercs working for slavers, the train derails, Velvet has to kill someone and takes it way worse than Pip did, but everyone survives. They're stuck on the wrong side of some mountains now, though, and it turns out that Calamity didn't actually live in New Appaloosa, he's a wanderer. Velvet also refuses to go back to the stable, and Pip is too horny to leave her. They can't just stay where they are, though, so they decide, fuck it, let's just see where the road takes us. It seemed like a best idea at the time. So now they're hoofing it and happen upon a wrecked truck that belonged to the delivery company Ditsy ran before the war. They loot it for some soda and move on through the ruins of Cloudsdale, which sort of splashed down the last day into a highway. So crashed, really. Anyways, Cloudsdale is full of feral ghouls, so everything becomes a horror movie for a while until Pip hacks some turrets to defend them. Day thus saved, they continue on and runs into this filly calling herself Pinkie Bell, who runs a Pinkie Pie museum, and also has an undetonated balefire bomb. Like the full-size city-busting kind. Since this filly is ranting about how drugs can be used for good things because Pinkie Pie said so, and insists that the magical nukes is fireworks, they're like, well, shit, and take the horrible trek over the mountains to New Appaloosa with her in tow so she can be safe and not in possession of a weapon of mass destruction. Once they arrive at New Appaloosa, Ditsy immediately gloms onto this little mare as her new mom. One would think that Pip and co. would then settle down in New Appaloosa after all that, but it turns out the town sucks ass and actually did business with those slavers, so Pip and co. get banned from the city by the mayor. So they leave, and Pip spots an SPP tower in the distance, and for the first time wonders what it's like up close. Then those griffin mercenaries attack again. There's some air combat, Calamity is hurt, but they run into the top griffin, who's named God, with a A, W, and a D. Now, God likes the fact that these ponies have guts, and so she gives Pip a quest in exchange for not killing them all. Velvet remains with God as collateral, while Pip is to infiltrate a place called the Shattered Hoof Correctional Facility and gather intel on a rival mercenary group called the Deadeyes. Along the way, she begins to piece together the link between the slavers, Red Eye, and Alicorns. Pip manages to pull off her intel gathering mission and returns to God, who is true to her word. Pip and her friends remain at God's camp for the night, and Velvet takes the opportunity to be the asshole kind of vegan and re-eat everyone who eats meat, in spite of the fact of the serious lack of easily available food, and the ponies of this universe being clear omnivores. Everyone is a bit annoyed at this idiot stable mare for bitching about food in the middle of a fucking apocalyptic wasteland, but that conversation is cut short when God comes along and is like, hey, so, you did good. I just decided to go kill the Deadeyes. Wanna help? And Pip is like, well, we don't really have any goal right now, so sure? And they don't really want to kill them, though, so Pip tries to push for a diplomatic situation involving Velvet putting on a show to charm them a little, and then maybe persuade them to just be friends. But the Deadeyes rig the stage to blow as a diversion to start a final slaughter. So Pip puts her experience in exploding large structures that she gained from Stable 24 to use, and blows up the Deadeye's base of operations. The Deadeye's leader is surprisingly chilled about this, and counteroffers for Pip to go kill God instead. Pip considers this very seriously, because it turns out their boss is a motherfucking dragon. In the end, Pip feeds the dragon a nice helping of grenades and loots some memory orbs from his hoard. Memory orbs being little recorders that, well, record memories. You can touch them, and then see the memory. It's pretty neat. This is how almost all pre-war exposition is given. If you want the pre-war exposition, please go see part one. Anyways, Pip winds up trading these orbs to God for a home in God's base, a little railroad camp/town called Junction R7. At this point, Pip is just real tired and wants a place to exist and not have to be shot anymore. Turns out she really doesn't like being shot. Who would have guessed? Anyways, that's exactly what doesn't happen to her next. Not the not getting shot part, the being able to settle down part. Pip gets to help rebuild and expand on Junction R7 for a bit, when suddenly she learns that her reputation is the thing that exists now. It's that, holy shit, this mayor is a dragon slayer. And also, this person called DJ Pony is talking about her exploits in detail. Like, weirdly a lot of detail that he really shouldn't know about, yet he doesn't mention her companions at all. Fucking strange, man. So strange, in fact, that it's off to Manhattan to see what the hell is up with this whole DJ deal. It's a long journey, and a lot happens. Notably, they find an old Skywagon, fight a Hydra, Calamity is revealed to have his cutie marks burnt off by some assholes long ago, and explains that it was because he got kicked out of a group, and specifically, he used to be an Enclave soldier, but they kicked him out for not being racist. Then some Alicorns attack, and Pip is horrified to learn that they remember her killing them, as if she'd killed all of the ones she is now fighting, instead of just the one back in the train yard. Things go to shit real quick, because it turns out you can't use the same trick on a hive mind twice. Fortunately, a passing Steel Ranger paladin named Steel Hoobs had his heart grow 3 sizes that day, and opened fire on the Alicorns with about 1 metric buckton of 20mm grenades and saves the day, while seemingly being fatally wounded. Pip checks him out and sees it's actually just that his armor is shut down, so he's paralyzed by it, and also he can't get out. Turns out his spell matrix is similar to a Pip Buck, so she could fix it, if she had a spell matrix master key. Steel Hooves is surprised to know that she knows anything at all about machines, and so he tells her to head to the nearby Stable 29, which he believes should have one. Pip and Co. head to Stable 29, and along the way tensions mount, because it turns out that Calamity thinks that Velvet is hot, and since Velvet is straight and Calamity is handsome, she flirts back with him. Our poor lesbian is the Devastate, and also very jealous. Anyways, Stable 29 is a huge tomb. It's real spoopy, with just robots going about maintaining things and the like for a while before the stable goes all Skynet on Pip and Co., because it turns out the stable was run by a Crusader mainframe that was unfortunately set up as a paperclip maximizer and killed every pony because a water talisman was broken and producing less and less water so the stable could support fewer and fewer ponies. Pip and her friends managed to survive this System Shock 1 tier AI malice and escape the stable with the master key, and also some memory orbs from made by Vinyl Scratch, along with some records. Because hey, why not prioritize saving some music records when you're in the middle of being attacked by an AI that is mid-
Look at you, hacker. A pathetic creature of meat and bone, panting and sweating as you run through my corridors. How can you challenge a perfect, immortal machine?
Pip is also really addicted to party time mentals by this point, and since she's not trusting her friends due to their flirting, she starts hiding her pills so they won't take them. Her addiction's actually kind of a big, notable thing. She keeps thinking she can only be intelligent with them and starts acting stupider and stupider without them. Anyways, Pip fixes Steelhoof's armor up, and he takes them back to the shack he's been living in, where Pip suddenly succumbs to an illness of some kind. She spends a few days resting up in the shack, overhears some discomforting conversations about her stable and how it might have been up to no good or have major problems of her own, but she's too sick to do anything. After Pip recovers, Steelhoofs tells her that he's grateful for the help and offers to repay the kindness by escorting them to Ten Pony Tower, where DJ Pony is. Along the way, Pip becomes convinced that Steelhoofs is actually a specific pre-war pony she's seen in one of her memory orbs, but she can't prove it. She also doesn't think he's a ghoul, because she asks, and it turns out Steelhooves really hates ghouls, like, a lot. Pip likes them, though, because even as the zombie pone, the Muffin Mayor is an adorably sweet adorableness, so Pip defends ghouls, and there's some grumbling on all sides. Anyways, Watcher turns up again via Spritebot, and talks to Pip for a bit. He agrees that Steelhooves does sound and act like someone specific, but it's all vague and mysteriously unhelpful, like everything Watcher says, really. After that, the group, minus Watcher, who just bucked off again, head into a monorail station. They fight a very angry robot tank, discover an old Zebra plot to destroy Manhattan that never occurred, and Pip finds a magic AK-47 on one of the dead Zebes because Zebra weapons are frickin' terrifying. This thing turns every single bolt into a flaming round of death. Anyways, they make their way to Tenpony finally, taking the monorail track on over to it. Velvet decides to be nice to Pip to make up a bit for the whole unrequited impossible love thing. She uses some caps she squirreled away during the trip to buy herself and Pip both a spa treatment. Amazingly, Pip bumps into Monterey Jack again here. Turns out he runs a cheese shop at the tower. He and Pip have some words, old times are reminisced. A helpful mayor named Homage points out some of Tenpony's laws, and Monterey then admits to having robbed Pip. Pip chats with Homage for a bit, and it comes out that Pip is upset about being into a straight mare and how few choices she had in the stable for a special sum pony, and how all those choices are now basically zilch. Homage is very understanding and sympathetic. Pip decides to then go ask DJ Pony how he learned about her, which was, you know, the mission objective. Homage tags along because it turns out she is the DJ's secretary. Well, actually, she's DJ Pony, but she doesn't want the tower's residents to know that, because she holds very different beliefs from them. She's cool with Pip learning about this particular secret, though, because of Homage's own dark secret. She is also an absurdly horny lesbian, and Pip is her type. She doesn't let Pip know this at the time, though. She's just being nice and kind and seeing just how interested Pip might be. The standard things. Later on, Homage takes Pip out for some breakfast. It's not a date, it's just like a friendly thing, and they talk about Monterey Jack a little bit more during this. Pip also gives Homage the records she found in Stable 29, which may as well have been an engagement ring, given Homage's sheer amount of squee about it, but again, their romance doesn't take off at this point. It's just now Homage's all of the happies. So happy that she immediately plays some of the records on air, and then decides to give Pip a quest to pop over to a corporate office to pick up some stuff. She's offering a flux regulator as payment, which Calamity wants real bad because he could use it to fix that mostly intact Skywagon they found earlier, so they take the job. Homage presumably feels real dumb as they leave, realizing that she could have just promised Pip a good licking. Anyways, on the way to the quest zone, Steelhooves does some grumbling, Calamity gets real mad at a propaganda poster showing Pegasi power armor, and then they have a real bad time passing through a Ministry Hub office to get to the office building. And this whole problem involves setting off every alarm in the place and making some robots very angry. Also, there's a whole thing with some flying horriblenesses. So, during this whole incident, Little Pip happens across Pinky's body and feels real bad about everything relating to that can of bees. She also picks up a little tape, which has Pinky's last message to her friends on it. After this, some shenanigans occur. Pip winds up having a random encounter in an old parking garage where she kills a mad scientist who was experimenting on ponies seemingly just because. This is actually something that Red Eye set up to gather data for his own operations, but this is not really explained or indicated very well by the story. Oh, and by the way, this takes us to the end of the 21st day that Pip has spent outside of Stable 2. Just keep the timeline roughly in mind as we continue. So the next morning, Pip has the stuff from the office that Homage wanted, and she also has an epiphany about that whole virtue thing that Watcher was on about, specifically that virtues can be twisted into evil forms, and that the Wasteland does that to a pony real fast. She also realizes that there is a component to virtues called Spark that makes multiple virtues work as one bigger thing. And Pip goes back to the Tenpony Tower at this point to turn in the quest item for her XP and loot. Pip gets the stuff, and remembering that Homage can effectively see the entire Wasteland, she asks Homage if she knows of any lesbians who are looking for a pony like her. And Homage is all,
"Well, of course I know him. He's me."
Thus, Pip obtains a waifu for laifu. Pip also introduces Velvet to Homage so she can sing for the radio and gets two free dresses as a thank you. Meanwhile, Tenpony has heard about the whole Monterey Jack thing and they're like, bruh, not cool. So he's arrested and slated for execution. His kids come up to Pip and it's a whole thing. Pip just wants to break Jack out after that, but she's informed that if she does, she will be banned from the tower and Homage sure as fuck won't be leaving it because she's so done with the Wasteland after her own life of adventuring. And Homage would thus also be kicked out if she went to go see Pip, so Pip does nothing. Pip is disgusted by the situation and leaves to get some air. They futz around Manhattan for a bit and run smack dab into an alicorn. Velvet manages to shoot the thing through the throat, but the alicorn is all, "Ha ha! Little do you know, I was bitten by a radioactive Deadpool, and regenerates the wound. The situation is narrowly escaped, as two more alicorns get eaten with surprise attacks, and Steelhoof is revealed to be a ghoul, actually. Pip runs into a problem moments later, with what regenerating alicorns and other dangers of Manhattan being in overdrive at the moment, so she tries to take a hit of PTM to come up with a plan, and it just doesn't help. Like, at all. Doesn't do anything. Pip's pretty freaked out by this and gets a little mentally paralyzed, but fortunately Calamity swoops in to save the day at the last minute. They escape with Pip having a bad case of rebar through the leg and a dead Pip buck. Everything gets real shitty at this point, and Pip finally acknowledges that she has an addiction, probably because what with her bucked up leg, she already feels that she's at the bottom of the barrel, and she also wants to improve for her new waifu for Laifu. They find some griffins who want to break into Tenpony Tower shortly after this. Steelhoof points out why that's a bad idea and how their plan won't work. Griffins are thankful for this, and since Pip is in tight with the griffin warlord they respect, they give the group a radio to call them if they need any help or find a good paying job. Watcher then shows back up as they leave for the griffins, and he's actually helpful for the first time, telling Pip flat out that he needs a black opal for something very important. Pip agrees to help him because he's being straight with her for the first time, and he's also come to the realization that this guy is probably real important, as he's been failing at whatever virtue thing he's been trying to do for centuries now, simply because he's been lacking ponies with enough virtue with a capital V. Pip then feels that she can return to Tenpony, so they do. Velvet gets a pet Balefire Phoenix along the way, and once they arrive, Calamity and Velvet discuss options for treating Pip's addiction. The treatment option available is real painful, and seems to be basically a full blood replacement via transfusion along with a chem cocktail. It sucks ass, but it works. Pip now realizes just how much of a drug haze she's been in for the last few weeks, and the doc explains to her that while PTM is an int booster, regular use of it makes you progressively dumber, until you need the PTM to function a little bit under how you normally would if you'd never took it at all. And then Pip's like, well, fuck, no one told me that. And she's kind of upset about it. It also turns out that addiction runs in Pip's family, with her mother having been a serious alcoholic, which might help explain Pip's tiny size. This is, of course, assuming that, unlike most ponies in Stable 2, Pip's family tree forks. Calamity then apologizes to Pip for introducing her to PTMs, and says he never would have if he knew she was vulnerable to addiction like that. Pip's cool with it. She then uses Steel Hooves armor to jumpstart her Pip Buck, bringing her back to proper form for the first time in a long time. Shortly after that conversation, Steelhoof settles a grudge by tricking Tenpony's security chief into a locked room with some hungry feral ghouls. Fortunately, only Pip finds out. See, almost immediately after, Pip is whisked away by security, and she's freaking out because of Steelhoof's spontaneous murder, but it turns out that they were executing Monterey Jack, in fact, they just had, and as per Tenpony law, since he wronged Pip, and if he was executed for that particular crime, all of Jack's shit is Pip's now, if she can pay the transfer fee. Pip is devastated because she'd hoped his kids would be the ones to get his shop and stuff so they could, you know, continue to live. But it's even worse than that. His kids are being thrown out of the tower for her father's crime, too. So, thoroughly disgusted at Tenpony's bullshit laws, Pip goes rockstar in her new room. As she happens across a bunch of PTM pills in her rampage, she's tempted but flushes them, finding satisfaction in that. Hamach walks in as Pip is flushing last the pills and takes her waifu for Laifu back home for some dinner. Also some love, the kind you clean up with the mop and bucket. Anyways, the next morning, Pip learns that Homage actually has a black opal. Now, these are really rare, really expensive, valuable things, so Homage isn't just willing to give it over to her, but she is willing to give it in exchange for a serious favor, which is surprisingly not sexual. Homage wants access to the SPP Tower in Philadelphia, as she has not been able to broadcast to that region for a long time, since Red Eye somehow took her offline there. Pip agrees. During this moment, Pip notices that Homage has a very weird, distressing to look at energy weapon in her safe that is absolutely, totally, super not an alien weapon. Homage is all like, oh yeah, it fell from the sky and it really creeps zebras out, but it disintegrates shit real good. This weapon and a few others like it are fairly plot critical later on, mostly used as bombs and ways to destroy very powerful foes very efficiently. I say these because there are more than, in fact, one alien disintegration blaster. Surprisingly enough, Homage hands over the black opal before Pip does her side of the job, and Watcher pops up as Pip is leaving Tenpony to take care of her side of that job. Pip is all, hey, I have the opal you wanted, but I'll only give it to you in person, you unnecessarily mysterious bucker you, to which Watcher is like, okay, and then DMs Pip his address. Moving on from that, Calamity has everyone go back to that downed Skywagon they found earlier and uses the flux regulator he got from Homage via Pip to fix it. Fast travel thus unlocked, they take off for Watcher's Place. They land near the coordinates that he gave after about a day's flight to get some rest. But before anyone can get to sleep, Pip notices her Pipbuck map is labeling the cave pretty close to them as Dragon's Cave, and before the "oh no" can really set in, a huge dragon lands near them, and it turns out that's Watcher, so it's cool. Also, Watcher's real name is Spike. He used to be Twilight Sparkle's friend and assistant. You know, the mayor who ran the Ministry of Arcane Science. So Spike's real polite and hospitable and invites every pony in for tea, like, actual tea. Except Steelhooves. Steelhooves has to wait outside. Anyways, Spike's been sitting in his cave for 200 years guarding Twilight's second great invention, a massive terraforming device called the Gardens of Equestria. It was originally developed to dispose of taint and other failed IMP byproducts, but as the war intensified, Twilight also retooled it to get rid of balefire radiation and other basic contaminants from a massive area. If it could be turned on, it could clean up most of the wasteland and render a good chunk of it habitable. The problem is the device is powered by the elements of harmony, which need ponies attuned to specific virtues to switch on, and Spike's never been able to find the right ponies for it. After this explanation of what the buck he's been doing, he thanks Pip for the black opal. Turns out he was after this specific one. He knew Homage had it, and would offer it to Pip once Pip said she needed one. Black opals turn out to be actually a special kind of memory orb. This one was one Spike recorded, and it's nothing critical. It's just an image of the last time all six ministry mayors were together and having a good time. Spike just wanted to see them as he remembered them again. You see, Spike slept through the last day. He was doing the whole dragon hibernation thing. Went to sleep with everything fine aside from the war, and woke up to everything dead. He never got to say goodbye to anyone, or help protect Equestria. Heartstrings thoroughly hurt by this, Pip points out that several ponies she's met so far, she believes to embody some of the virtues Spike has been after all this time. Spike is grateful for the intel, and promises to check up on those leads. She then asks why Celestia can't just activate the Elements of Harmony since she willed them all once, and Spike's like, "Bruh, she's dead." Some brief explanations of Alicorn's not being gods are given to Pip, who it turns out to be devoutly religious in her stable's weird little religion. Spike just can't get through to Pip on this matter, but she accepts that Celestia cannot help with this. Pip then leaves the cave. Steelhooves has to be convinced that not being told what's in the cave is a good thing, which it is, because the Steel Rangers would abso-fucking-lutely steal that shit. And in the middle of this explanation, some Pegasi and power armor show up to ruin everyone's good time, mostly because the Enclave has apparently decided to start doing some scouting runs here and there. They didn't really count on there being a dragon nearby, this, like, random flying machine they were tracking, though, so they get roasted. Turns out the Enclave had some air support with them, though, specifically a small number of ships, so Pip and co. flee, leaving Spike to protect the gardens, as he's not really worried about the Enclave aircraft, given the Equestrian Air Force's track record versus dragons has a KD ratio of, like, zero to fucking zero. They've just never done well versus dragons. At all. Now, in spite of being banished from the town earlier, Pip and co. fly over to New Appaloosa to do some trading. Presumably it's conveniently close to the cave, or at least one evasive maneuver panic run close to the cave. Once they've geared up and resupplied, they take off for Philadelphia. On the way, Steelhooves mentions they're passing over Hellhound territory, and talks about how they used to be called Diamond Dogs, and that they were mutated into their current forms via industrial waste products dumped into the reservation they were forced into. They went from mostly harmless tribals to very hostile tribals that can now slice through almost anything with their claws. Foreshadowing! Shortly after they stopped to change the Skywagon's battery, they just happened to touch down for this at a power plant, so Pip explores it while Calamity fixes up their ride. Pip discovers evidence of some pony else lockpicking inside, and suddenly realizes that apparently only she and this mystery pony have ever tried to open any locked thing ever in the wasteland. Thoroughly confused by this, she stumbles onto evidence that Equestria's entire power economy was based on coal, which they didn't have much of, and had to import it from Zebrica. Thoroughly mad at this pre-war dumb, Pip almost doesn't notice as they're ambushed by hellhounds. Hellhounds are about 10 times worse than Steelhooves implied. Turns out they can basically lightsaber their way through things, and while they are primitive socially, they are and still people smart. After just barely escaping the hellhounds via the use of a door covered in a frankly absurd amount of landmines with the terrifying effect of liquefying the things that they explode, they speed off in the Skywagon and get back on track for Philadelphia. On the way, they run into some other Steel Rangers, and a tense standoff happens until Steelhooves is like, "Oi, I'm a paladin," and they stand the buck down. He arranges for a meeting with the chapter's elder by pulling his rank 2, and everypony goes with. While walking out to the nearby ranger HQ for the meeting, Pip learns that Steel Hooves is something of a political outcast, and not really with the rangers, but also not with the rangers. He basically got half-kicked out for not being a tech hoarder and asshole-ish enough. The rangers and Pip suddenly find themselves in a brief battle against some of Red Eye's raiders. This is convenient, as Pip just learned Philadelphia has been under Red Eye's total control for the last 3 years. They survived the attack easily because a bunch of power armor clad murder hobos versus some dudes in old football pads is, well, really ridiculously one-sided and can only go one way. They arrive at the Rangers HQ, which happens to be the old StableTech main office. Pip gets invited to meet with the Elder. The Elder actually explains that he knows a bit about who she is and what she's pulled off, and they offer to help her sneak into Philly, which is kind of necessary given that Red Eye has actually secured and fortified it. Like, the whole goddamn city. Pip asks what they want in exchange, and it turns out that Red Eye has some information that the Rangers want. Specifically, the Raider King has access to knowledge required to create bypass spells, and also a means of using radiation to generate electrical power. Now, Pip's not one to turn down bonus XP, so she says yes. She starts to go about her business with the Rangers' help when she discovers that Steel Hooves isn't your average ordinary ghoul. He's a Canterlot ghoul. I.e., he was made from Pink Cloud, not Balefire. This means he's actually a Cronenberg creature infused to the inside of his armor that managed to keep his old mind. So anyways, the Rangers sneak into Pip into Philadelphia, disguised as a slave, via some slavers they bribed. The slavers bring Pip through the city's wall, and while doing so, her Pip buck is noticed because duh. So she's earmarked to be sent to someone called Doc Slaughter to get it removed. Pip is very spooked by this because no Pip buck means no cloaking device. She's also further freaked out when one of the slavers is casually killed without thought by a raider because the slaver dared to talk during one of Red Kai's speech broadcasts. This raider, named Stern, then goes on a mini-ramble to the new slaves, informing them that they may earn their freedom by working 2 years in the stable recovery team, 4 months in the Philly crater, or they could become the champion of the Apex Games, survive long enough in the gladiatorial arena, or they could just die, or be sold to Unity. Their choice. Pip then gets temporarily assigned to working in an old amusement park, where she is almost raped by a raider in a very, very uncomfortable scene which really sells the raiders as evil buckers. By the way, it's been 31 days since Pip left her stable. Anyways, Pip is woken the next morning by a raider who tells her that because she has a Pip buck still, she's gotta do a job that needs a pony with a Pip buck. So Pip does. It goes badly because Pip isn't really used to using magical energy weapons, and the job is killing Parasprice with one. Pip manages to sneak some supplies out during this mission, though. She's then assigned to some scrap collection duty, and while talking with some slaves also on that duty, she learns roughly where to go to get what the Rangers have yet told her to do, and also roughly what she needs to do to fulfill Homage's little part of this mission. Red Eye then happens to be walking around doing some stuff nearby, and Pip notices him, and specifically spots his Pip buck under his cloak, and realizes he's a stable dweller like her. That kind of screws their head, like, a lot. Ethics, morality, religion, that kind of thing. Anyways, Red Eye gives this speech about his plans for the Wasteland, what he learned in his stable, how he met the goddess, and how his stable was the first to be dismantled in an effort to begin his new plans. He's not giving it to Pip, he's giving it to everyone in general. He just does this a lot. Huge ego. At the end of his speech, he offers a day of respite, and specifically to watch the event in the pit, which some slaves that Pip met and like both volunteer for. Pip later blows her cover, trying to save one of them from being raped, gets stealth grabbed by a cloak out alicorn using one of Pip's own tricks, because again, they're all the same person actually, and Pip is then drugged in front of Red Eye. Now Red Eye isn't dumb, he knows who Pip is, he listens to the radio, so he's all, "We're not so different, you and I," because you don't get to make that speech too often as a villain and actually have it really mean something, and it's also a cool speech. He then has Pip sentenced to death battle in the pit. So Pip is waiting for her turn in the arena and starts hearing ponies die within seconds. This is because her opponent is a zebra named Zenith, who we later learn knows how to make a zebrakin super soldier serum. And there's absolutely no way she didn't use that serum on herself in the past, because name a reason you wouldn't use a super soldier serum that you can make with random ingredients scavengeable in a wasteland. Oh, well, the actual evidence is that Zenith has been slated to be executed by the raiders, and they've tried a dozen different methods, including setting her on fire. And none of them worked, which is all stuff Pip gets to hear by one other pony who's in the arena and talking about her and not wanting to fight her. So Pip gets her turn up at bat and is basically instantly raffle stomped by Captain Zebrica, but because Pip is the not alicorn princess of telekinesis, She manages to choke Zenith out into right into unconsciousness. She then refuses to kill Zenith when given the hoofs down by Caesar, the arena master, so the raiders open fire. Pip responds by using some of the arena's random barrels of radioactive acid, presumably on loan from Black Mesa, to make a shield, and she gets herself and Zenith to safety because she likes to collect mares, I guess. Zenith is grateful and swears a life debt. Pip is like, ha ha, you'll get to pay that off now, as they do their best to escape the Raider City. They wind up in Red Eye's quarters by pure chance and manage to loot a ton of stuff, including what Pip came for in the first place. Zenith also gets some alchemy equipment, which just makes her little striped heart flutter ever so much since he's a potion maker by trade. Unfortunately, they're suddenly attacked by a giant super alicorn. That is completely unfair because it's also wearing armor. Now, this alicorn is a super alicorn because it got real pissed that Pip was escaping yet again, so it dove into a big old pile of radioactive waste to go Super Saiyan 3 specifically to kick Pip's plot clean the buck off. A serious battle is had. Pip's victory is snatched via a maneuver she genuinely didn't think would work, and she's just as shocked as the reader that it works, actually. So after that, she and Zenith cheese it before this thing regenerates. They wind up being chased down by Red Eye's cyber dog and some of his soldiers, and when backed to a corner, Red Eye's all, hey, not bad. Tell you what, agree to a job for me, and you're free to go. For realsies, I'll even let you keep the stuff you've stolen. And Pip, who oh so loves bonus XP, is all, okay, but what though? Red Eye's like, hey, I need you to kill my ally, the goddess. It's mostly because he doesn't ever want to have to use the cursed your sudden but inevitable betrayal speech. And Pip agrees to this. Mostly because Red Eye has all the cards, actually, and informs Pip that he will detonate a balefire bomb, recover from that one random Philly's Pinkie Pie Museum, and use it to destroy Ten Pony Tower with Pip's waifu inside if she does not. So, as Pip leaves Philadelphia to go do that, she notices on her radio that DJ Pony is broadcasting in Philly again for the first time in years. It strengthens her resolve enough to go put on her Big Mayor panties and go try to kill God. So Pip goes and meets the goddess, but it turns out that she's actually really nice, but in like an insane person way.
In my talons, I shape clay, crafting life forms as I please. Around me is a burgeoning empire of steel. From my throne room, lines of power careen into the skies of Earth. My whims will become lightning bolts that devastate the mounds of humanity. Out of the chaos, they will run and whimper, praying for me to end their tedious anarchy. I am drunk with this vision. God, the title suits me well.
She's willing to talk and make deals and reveals that she knows her own origin story, but really doesn't care at all. After all that whole exposition, she turns to Pip and is like, hey, do you like bonus XP? And Pip is all, do I? So Pip agrees to go to Canterlot and retrieve the Black Book of for the goddess. Mostly because Pip has no idea how the fuck you'd actually kill this Cronenberg monstrosity. So Pip heads to Canterlot to go pick up the book, but is interrupted by the fact that a bunch of Steel Rangers have decided to raid her home stable. Pip goes full on rage panic and zips over to sort that out. It's a hell of a thing, but it's done. Primarily done by Steel Hooves, who manages to make a lot of the Rangers see things his way. It doesn't hurt that the Rangers sort of worship Applejack the way Catholics worship the Virgin Mary, and Pip points out that they are currently raiding the place where Applejack is buried. Also, Steel Hooves reveals himself to have been Applejack's special sum pony way before the war. That helps a whole bunch too. This is the dawn of a new faction of Rangers now loyal to Steel Hooves, who dub themselves as Applejack's Rangers. Pip resumes her journey to Canterlot after this and stops at a town called Erebu. Shit goes south real bad there for Pip. Long, horrible, depressing story short, the town sells pony meat to unknowing ponies. Pip snaps and kills all of the people involved in the pony meat trade. Men, women, children, all of them. This shakes her reputation as a hero somewhat. From this point on, Little Pip is demonized in the minds of some ponies as the Hellmare, the pony who had exterminated an entire town with bullets of fire. Even though her anger was justified and both Homage and Calamity quickly come to forgive her for it, Pip never really truly forgives herself for her actions at Erebu. Shaken extremely badly, Pip makes it to Canterlot. And the whole thing is a sci-fi horror movie. Pip and her friends to hop from ministry hub to ministry hub, making their way through horrible clouds of necromantic gas and actual hordes of horrible monstrosities of Cronenbergian creatures and bizarre fusions of pony flesh and random objects, and they make their way all the way to Rarity's old office in her ministry hub, which is where the goddess believed the book to be. And they get it, but it's a huge ordeal involving another dragon who's actually been fused with a pink cloud mega spell, which is actually how the gas was still here all this time. The dragon just makes more of it by breathing now. So that's one hell of a breath weapon to face. Pip manages to solve that problem, but gets her pip buck fused to her leg during this adventure. And that freaks her out a lot because she's worried she's mutating away from the goddess's pure plan for ponykind. And she also has a few close calls with alicorns who are searching the ruins for the book, too. Turns out the goddess's control over alicorns doesn't work within Pink Cloud, hence why she needed Pip's help. It's also why these alicorns are still actually hostile to Pip. They did not get the memo that Pip is currently working for them. The alicorns are mostly just kind of lost beyond reason, wandering around in the cloud, saying things to you like, "I think I was a cult once," and other stuff as their minds slowly come back to them. Or they just go stark raving mad and come up with a whole alternate personality, call it the goddess, use it to give themselves orders since they can't handle being separated from the community, and just become a whole fucking problem for everyone and everything. So yeah, Canterlot sucks. Anyways, Pip and her friends finally get her hands on the Black Book of Kalatu, Baratus, and Zenith reunites with her daughter. Happy days. Now it's real time to return to the goddess. Pip concocts an elaborate plan, which involves a lot of work to pull off and is really compartmentalized since the goddess can read minds, the TLDR of which is Pip sneaks Red Eye's bomb out from under Tenpony, and even though her love is safe now, Pip knows the goddess has to go since she's after an indestructible, horrible book of dark evil magic. So Xena smuggles the bomb while Pip pretends to be turning the book over, the bomb's blown, the goddess is killed, and so is Pip nearly. Mostly by the fact that she detonated a nuke a few meters away from her. So the goddess's death does some weird things, not only to the alicorns of the Unity, but also to the local fabric of space-time itself. As a part of this, Twilight Sparkle's conscious mind briefly recoalesces within a random purple alicorn, and Twilight rescues Pip from a sure death from radiation poisoning, or drowning in radioactive acid, or both, or something worse. Pip uses this opportunity to let Twilight see Pinky's last message to her. Whether or not Twilight's able to hear the entire message is unclear, as Twilight dissipates during or just after the recording, and that alicorn body slash person just staggers off dazed and confused without the goddess's or Twilight's control. Pip then kind of just sits down and has a panic attack about how irradiated and mutated she's becoming, and is terrified she might not even be considered a pony anymore, and is thus impure and unworthy because religion. Aside from that, everything seems like it's mostly a happy ending, aside from Red Eye still existing, but, you know, you can't solve everything, especially not as one mayor who is super fucking done with all this bullshit. Pip decides to just go back to Tenpony. She's just done. Time to go back to Tenpony. Everyone regroups to go back, but they parked too close to a Hellhound tribe's den, and Steel Hooves gets decapitated by one. Turns out that while Canterlot ghouls can regenerate from almost anything, they can't regenerate from decapitation. I guess they worked on Highlander rules. So Steel Hooves is dead. A funeral is held, and once the Hellhounds are dealt with. It's a sad but tragic last point in a long, harrowing adventure. No? No. See, the goddess was something that the Enclave was monitoring. Blowing her up had them go, "Wewa," and then double-check the state of the wasteland. Their council decided that with the threat of the goddess gone, now was the time to descend from the sky and take back the world. That, or they're summoned by the alarms going off in the Ministry of Awesome HQ in Canterlot that Pip's all just made all blare at the same time because Dash rigged that up as a prank. It's not clear which of these it is, or if it's both, but regardless, the Enclave arrive and begin to turn the wasteland to Vietnam II, Ride of the Valkyries, with what they call Operation Cauterize, as part of their bid to take full control of Equestria once and for all. Pip watches a place called Friendship City fall to the Enclave, and decides she's got to try and do something. Anything about this. She manages to save New Appaloosa from the Enclave, but that's not really all that much, and it turns out there's not much one mayor can do about an entire army with airships and sky tanks galore. So Pip, feeling the need to do anything at all, decides that in this chaos, there is some good she might be able to do. Kill Red Eye. Because of the whole Enclave attack and also to advance the next stage of his plans, Red Eye has moved from Philadelphia to his old stable, Stable 101. It's located in the Everfree Forest, and Pip manages to track its location down, then fights her way to the forest. And so are the Enclave for some reason. Pip winds up in the middle of a horrible clusterfuck of a battle between herself, the Shadow Bolts, the Enclave, and a cybernetic dragon that Red Eye has under his command. And instead of being all, buck this shit, I'm out, Pip pushes ahead right into the heart of the deadly forest as it's being burnt to the fucking ground. Battling through the hostile forest, Pip and her friends discover Fluttershy alive, but transformed into a willow tree by killing Joke. They also learn that Red Eye has a serious god complex as he constructed a legit cathedral where his old stable was before he dismantled it, and he intends to rule from this cathedral after ascending to godhood, which he believes he can do, because he's perfected the transformation that made the goddess. And he very well may have, actually. A lot of work was put into this plan, including experiments from countless wasteland scientists he paid to do his dirty work. And as mentioned previously, Red Eye isn't an idiot. As Little Pip confronts Red Eye alongside Calamity's brother Autumn Leaf, who's there because he happens to be a high-ranking Enclave soldier, Red Eye reveals to the both of them that he is convinced he can become a true Alicorn, if only a powerful Pegasus and Unicorn join with him. That is why Pip and Calamity's brother are there. Red Eye intentionally lured them specifically, and allowed for them to reach his innermost sanctum so that they could dive in the vat together, and through mutual sacrifice, create the leader Equestria needed. Of course, Red Eye believed his personality would dominate in this merger, so he wouldn't actually die, he'd just be using them to upgrade his body, soul, and magical abilities. However, Red Eye did not count on the fact that Colonel Autumn Leaf came equipped with a squad of mind-controlled hellhounds. Red Eye is killed in the resulting fight, and Pip executes Autumn Leaf before escaping as the dragon battle and the explosions involved in the hellhound fight have the entire cathedral crumbling to bits as if Red Eye was a video game boss. Ironically, Red Eye's plan and words make Pip realize something. He was sort of correct. Ponies do need something to unite around, and it has to be a person. Pip is no Alicorn, although she does think she might be partially one given her mutations. But she does think that she can bring the sun back to the wasteland. After all, the Enclave may have Pegasi weather control, but the single Pegasus project exists, and Pip is pretty sure that they cannot fight a weather machine. Also, Pip realizes that if she can take control of the skies and remove all the clouds from above Equestria, because Pegasi build from clouds, this would remove all the Enclave's infrastructure in one fell swoop. The thing is, everything she's learned about the SPP so far has her believe that actually entering it to use it is permanent, as in she'd become part of the SPP network to control it, likely via a consciousness upload. Pip's okay with this. Her mental state has spiraled to basically the horrible, horrible, horrible depths of depression from everything that's been going on, but mostly the Erebu thing. Except that was literally less than a week ago, so she's really still processing through that. She's also definitely pretty concussed in this moment, and, well, no one can come to terms with the tragedy that fast, like at all. And so Pip's whole world is just collapsing because all these events occurring to her in, like, a month and a week of time have kind of driven her just right to the edge of sanity. So Pip, in her despair, decides she'll sacrifice herself to save the world. There is a lot of planning that goes into obtaining access to the SPP hub, mostly because tons of people have tried before and failed. It's secured by this allegedly impenetrable shield, which might be genuinely indestructible, which is a thing that could have been done with the Black Book by Rarity. Lots of things have been tried by this, even using the bones of Luna to try and get through, hoping that there was a bypass spell on it to allow Alicorns through. So, Pip engages in some battle planning, and everything's really elaborate. They contact people that they have helped from all across the wasteland, and they get all their allies together to defeat the Red Eye's remaining forces and the Enclave soldiers. The battle is huge, and it's also just a huge diversion to allow Pip to access the SPP's control hub. And Pip's plan doesn't work. She can't get in. She thought she could pull it off since her various mutations and other things about her brain that are going on right now had given her the impression that she was 3/5 Alicorn, but no. Her cunning plan involving her weird religious beliefs and cursory knowledge of bypass spells did not mean she could just walk straight through the force field. Then, remembering something that she heard Pinky say in a recording, it clicks. Pip remembers that Spike told her Celestia had gone to the hub, and then died there. She also remembers that Spike mentioned that he could use his fire to magically send things to Celestia. And what she remembers Pinky mentioning in that recording is that the way to the end is through fire. So Pip goes to Spike and tries to get him to burn her alive to teleport her past the force field. Spike refuses. He won't hurt her. Nothing living has ever survived his fire. Pip provokes him by using her knowledge of Twilight having been sort of alive within the goddess this entire time. Enraged, Spike burns her, and Pip is transported. She sees the bones of many other things Spike has killed, and doesn't understand how she's alive. She is. Worked. Pip explores the hub, and is shocked to learn that due to some Ministry of Awesome and stable tech work that Celestia was unaware of, she is now an AI trapped within the SPP network. Sadly, all Celestia can do is watch the wasteland. She can't use the radios or the weather control system. Because no one wanted an AI to have control of a weather control system that covers an entire nation. This means Celestia can't help any pony. She can only watch them suffer and die. As a result, she's in a really, really bleak place, but she's still a very kind mayor. Celestia lets Pip see all of her friends so she knows that they survived the battle. Homage proves to be a little bit eldritch because when she's being viewed by Pip on the screen, in spite of not even knowing Pip's in the SP hub due to not having been part of the battle at all, but having been in the wilderness this whole time dodging the Enclave, Homage Act looks directly into the camera on a random kilometer tall tower near her and mouths, "I love you, Pip." Somehow not questioning this event at all, Pip continues about her business. In spite of Pip being the only pony she's been able to talk to for centuries, Celestia, who can still cast some spells, just not anything outside the room her mainframe is in, opens a portal for Pip to leave so she's not trapped there forever. Then Celestia is all, quote, "Because now I know where I've seen you. Twilight's last act was to save you. Was it for this? For you to give your life up just a week later?" Yeah, it's been a fucking week, you dumb, traumatized horse. If only some pony had thought to give Pip some weed and then, like, a therapist, she could probably have come up with a better plan. But she doesn't. Pip refuses to leave several more times, and Celestia gives up persuading her. It didn't even matter when that Celestia pointed out that any pony could come in the same way and do the cloud plan later. Pip is convinced that if the Enclave is not beaten now, they'll never get another chance. And she's in too dark a state to think about any alternative plans, but she's probably actually correct about that. The Enclave is pretty powerful, and it's doubtless that the same tricks that they use to be able to actually get near the SPP hub, which happens to be very close to their main headquarters, would ever work again. I mean, hell, Pip also believes that if she doesn't even remain active in the pod indefinitely, Enclave Pegasi may just close off the sky again. She's probably right about that, too. So Pip goes to the SPP control pod, and well, it's not as dark and dire as she believes, since her note did not contain how to enter the SPP hub. Once she's in the pod, no one will be able to get her out. And she won't be able to get out herself after she's inside. It puts you just into a semi-stasis. Pip is at peace with this. Maybe she's even a little bit happy, given her mental state. As her last few acts, Pip sits down in the pod, arranges her personal effects and mementos from her friends all around herself. She then rigs the pod to record her thoughts and broadcast her story to the wasteland, closes the pod, banishes the clouds, and Pinky was correct. The last day finally dies, being in sunshine and rainbows. Pip's message then plays to the wasteland, and it's the story you've been reading. Stream of consciousness summary of everything she's done and why, and since she was high most of the time, it's notable to realize that a lot of this was from an unreliable narrator. Pip's whole reason for broadcasting this message is mostly just a way to make her friends understand what she did and why. Through Pip's actions, though, the Enclave is defeated, and the sun is returned to the wasteland. Pip becomes a symbol, a lightbringer, something many rally around with and behind. The politically powerful, who were helped by Pip, decide to help make her dream of a nicer wasteland as real as they can. They found the new Canterlot Republic and declare Junction R7, renamed Junction Town, as its capital. It's not the best government, nor does it control all the wasteland, but it's something. The world is finally moving on from its destruction, all thanks to Pip. 10 years later, and the Alicorns of the Unity are all free and mostly sane. Their first foals are attending schools. Towns are able to prosper just a little bit. Ghouls are having some hard times, since, well, Spike at some point got the Gardens of Equestria fire, and ghouls need some radiation to live and remain healthy, so they're either going hungry or moving away to places where they can get the radiation they need to live, or trucking radioactive water in from places where it still is largely shitty. On the upside, this means all the ferals are pretty much gone. On the downside, this means that the pre-war survivors who know how things work and could help rebuild while they're suffering. But back on the positive side of things, Fluttershy was freed from being a tree and restored to her old self. She founded an organization to try and help the world get back onto its hooves, too. Also, she gets to see Spike, and they have a grand old time. Raiders are almost all extinct, too, and Applejack's Rangers have opened the what vaults that they could take over to share what tech the Steel Rangers had accumulated over the time. Pip's story has also been written down and printed, and will probably eventually become the NCR's Bible. Oh, and every year on her birthday, Homage gets herself burned alive to go spend the day with Pip. But the epilogue doesn't really make it clear if Pip can actually leave the pod or if she interacts with Homage via screens like Celestia does during these moments. However, it's pretty safe to say, at the very least, Pip is in that pod all days of the year, minus one. Oh, also, Homage apparently never thought to brought a radio into the hub and hook it up so Celestia can talk to people. Or if she has, this wasn't worth mentioning the epilogue. And in short, Pip did a lot of work and a lot of good. The Wasteland is better off in many ways, but there's still a lot of suck left in the world and a lot of room to improve. I would like to end this summary on a quick personal note. I've just summarized an entire book series worth of story in what my AI estimates will take an hour to record. Obviously, I have to have left a lot out. I also may have gotten a few details incorrect or made them misleading and muddy through my specific wording. I'm sorry for such human frailties, and I think I did my best to keep this short and to the point while also being entertaining. And now, on the extremely off chance she's listening, hello, kkat. Thank you for the wonderful story. Yes, I obviously have my issues with the ending, but it's not bad, especially when you understand Pip's logic and emotions. Fully understand you feeling like her having left the SPP would negate her sacrifice, disrupt the tone of the story, and be somewhat out of character for her, and, you know, you're right. I'm not asking you to do anything about that. But, while I know you're trying to step away from the fandom these days, could you please write something short, like just a one or two page blurb of Homage giving Celestia radio access? Please. Thank you. Good night, everybody.